allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, and welcome everyone to the March 7th, 2016 Bryan City Council meeting. First on the agenda is approval of minutes of the February 15 meeting. Those have been presented to the council members. Any corrections, additions, or comments need to be made on those minutes?
I did not see any corrections, so I move that we approve the minutes.
Second. Rick?
Yes.
Judy?
Yes.
Carrie?
Yes.
Keith?
Yes.
Tommy?
Yes. Next is hearing a public concern, and I see no one that will be addressing council that I'm aware of anyhow, so we'll go by on that. And next is an ordinance. So Lori, would you please number and read?
Ordinance number 9, 2016. An ordinance providing for annual appropriations for the City of Bryan for the fiscal year ending December 31st, 2016, and declaring an emergency. This is an appropriation request from the Fire Vehicle Fund for $34,000 for a pickup truck. It's also an appropriation request from the Bryan Municipal Utilities for a roof replacement project. It's to be split 70% from the Electric Fund, 20% from the Water Fund, and 10% from the Communications Fund. Total amount of roof replacement requested, $100,000 as an emergency. Total amount of appropriation requested,
$134,000. Any comments, Council? Lori, do you know what this is, what type of roof it is, and which building
it is? It's the roof over the main utilities building. It's been suffering leaks for at least a year now. In fact, I can tell you after a board meeting, Rhonda, Bryan, and I actually were moving furniture to prevent leaks from falling through in the boardroom, water from coming through. But they've got leaks all over down there,
gotcha.
And they requested this as an emergency replacement.
What have they done on this? Have they put it out for bid or anything like that? Or is there a timetable when
because of an emergency, there's no requirement
there
for bid
it?
In an emergency situation.
Gotcha.
And we personally saw the water pouring in the building.
So it sounds like it's going to go fairly quick?
Yes.
Okay.
Are they starting on it yet?
I don't think so. I don't know what the time frame is. I do know they have the contractor and can proceed, but just need the approval with the appropriation, and then the board will approve at their next meeting as well.
Okay. Thank you.
I move we suspend.
I'll second.
Keith?
Yes.
Rick?
Yes.
Judy?
Yes.
Carrie?
Yes.
Tommy?
Yes.
Move to adopt.
Second. Keith?
Yes.
Carrie?
Yes.
Judy?
Yes.
Rick?
Yes.
Tommy?
Yes. Okay, next is an ordinance. So Lori, would you please number and read?
Ordinance number 10, 2016. An ordinance authorizing the Bryan Fire Department to purchase a 2016 Chevrolet pickup truck.
Chief Siders.
Good evening.
Good evening, sir.
Previously, you approved the appropriation from the Fire Vehicle Fund for $34,000, and I'm asking Council to approve the Fire Department to purchase a 2016 Chevrolet pickup truck from Estrel Chevrolet in the amount of $33,156. We went to all three vehicle vendors here in the city, and Estrel was the best and lowest bid. So I ask that you would suspend the rules and approve this so that we can move forward before grass fire season is upon us.
Is this a replacement?
Yes, it's going to replace the current Dodge pickup truck. It's a 2002.
What's our plans for that vehicle?
We're trading that in.
We are?
Yes.
Okay. How soon, what's timetable on this? When would the vehicle be available, and then you have to make all the equipment changes on it or add equipment and things like that?
The vehicle, presently, they found a vehicle which is actually in Fort Wayne.
Okay.
It's on the lot, ready to go, so once we can get the approval from council, I write the PO, Lori approves of the set aside of the money, we'll move forward with getting the truck. So I would say probably within the week, we'll have it.
And switching all the equipment over?
Switching all the equipment's probably gonna take us a couple of weeks.
That's what I was gonna say.
Yeah.
So, yeah, it should be ready to go for?
By the end of the month, I would hope that it'd be done, or by the first of next month.
Grass fire season.
Yeah.
Gotcha. Counsel?
I move we suspend.
I second.
Keith?
Yes.
Judy?
Yes.
Carrie?
Yes.
Rick?
Yes.
Tommy?
Yes.
Move that we approve.
Second.
Rick?
Yes.
Keith?
Yes.
Judy?
Yes.
Carrie?
Yes.
Tommy?
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Next on the agenda is that we have a resignation and from a dispatch in the police department, and Chief Willis is gonna take care of that.
Good evening.
Evening.
In 1977, Sherry Cooper was hired by the city as a meter maid for the police department. She then transferred into the dispatch office and is currently a records dispatch supervisor. And after 38 years, she has decided to retire. So I am asking council to accept her resignation due to her retirement, which will be effective June 30th, 2016.
I like the way she put it, a lifetime later. She's retiring.
I'd like to say she was a huge asset to your department, I feel, and she was one of the first friendly faces that I had in Bryan. The cool thing was I went to school with her son in Ayersville, so she was a known friendly face in Bryan when I first moved here. But she was always very good at her job, so we will miss her.
Yes, we will.
We have to kind of look up the history, 38 years.
Yeah.
Here, she could be one of them.
She's hung out with you guys a very long time.
A long time, yes. Put up with a lot of us.
I move we accept this resignation with regrets and a big, big, big thank you.
I second that.
Keith?
Yes.
Carrie?
Yes.
Judy?
Yes.
Rick?
Yes.
Tommy?
As well, I do approve you, and with regrets, she did a nice job for you. So we are gonna miss her. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, then along with that line, Chief is requesting permission to advertise to hire for part-time dispatchers. So, Chief?
Well, with the retirement of Sherry, she also helped out in the dispatch area. I am asking permission from council to advertise so that I could hire two part-time dispatchers to help fill in with vacations, personal days, sick leave for the full-time dispatchers.
Where are you at right now in regards to how many full-time and how many part-time dispatchers do you have now?
We have one part-time, two records / dispatch clerks, which is Sherry and Donna, and then four full-time dispatchers.
Four full-time dispatchers, okay.
Yes.
And you're saying that, like Donna, she does records and then she also helps out in dispatch as well?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, she is mainly in the records, but when they start running short, she will fill in for the full-time. And but with Sherry leaving, then Donna's going to be covering part of her job, and our plans right now are not to replace Sherry, so that's why I'm asking for two part-time dispatchers.
Gotcha.
To help fill in
and cut down on the overtime.
So the two part-time or something like that would be kind of like a swing person even? Whereas that, they could fill, I think somewhere in there it said something about vacations and stuff like that.
Whenever the full-time take vacations, personal days, sick days, they would be able to call in the part-time dispatchers to fill in.
Right now.
Rather than having a full-time dispatcher come in and have to pay them overtime, we can fill it in with part-time dispatchers.
The one part-time that you have now?
Yes.
What, roughly, how many hours does that person get in a two-week period, pay period?
I think it's like 28, I believe it is, right around there.
Yeah, it's under the 30 hours.
Yes, yes.
Things like that, yeah.
Right, close.
Okay.
Yes, and with losing Sherry, then we're only allowed to give that part-time that we have now so many hours.
Correct.
We're going to have to do something else. That's why I'm asking for the couple more part-time.
Okay, council, your wishes?
As far as overtime, do you think that this will, I mean, how much overtime are you talking about right now that you tend to typically have in a normal season? Can you even guess?
Well,
I know I'm putting you on the spot.
I don't know right offhand. A lot of it right now is well, with the summer and everything coming up, they start taking vacations, and that's where we start running into a lot of overtime. Or if they take sick time, right now we're not too bad because Don is there to fill in, and Sherry's still there to cover the records and everything part of it. So when Sherry's gone, then Don is going to have to cover more of the records part, so we won't have Don.
So you're not saying you're going to do away with overtime altogether because you never know if people are going to call.
Right, I can't say we'll do away with it altogether.
But you're hoping it will significantly reduce.
Yes.
Okay, good. And I do appreciate that you know, are looking at part-time instead of another full as far as benefits go. Okay, I make a motion, we approve.
I'll second that.
Carrie?
Yes.
Tommy?
Yes.
Judy?
Yes.
Rick?
Yes.
Keith?
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you, Chief.
Thank you.
Okay, next on the agenda is a building permit, and I think, Mayor, with Andy's absent, you'll take care of that for us.
Okay, this is a building permit. It's for AmeriFirst Home Mortgage. They're relocating from the downtown area out to this 607 West High Street. The contractor is Star Homes by Della Grange out of Fort Wayne. The construction information is Zone C1, number of living units none, state construction type 5B, which is a structure type frame, and the state use group is B, which are for business offices. The cost of this is going to be $93,500. It's just a remodel of the existing building.
Can you explain where 1607 West High is? Where is that specifically? Get in their minds.
The chiropractor that's on the if you go on past the Sears corner, the first building is a chiropractor in there. It's on past that. It's a house next to that. There's been several. The prosthetic group is in there.
Sam Santorita.
Sam Santorita's
property.
Before that, I think there was a
Dentist, wasn't it?
Dentist
or medical or something.
Yeah.
Okay. I think there's a lot of people probably would
Paisley,
like to hear that.
Paisley was in that.
Okay.
And when he left, gave some of the equipment to the fire department. So it's kind of it looks almost like a house there, but it would be for offices and so forth for AmeriFirst Home Mortgage.
All right.
You say something, Tyson?
It's on the corner of Brewster Drive.
Oh, on Bruce.
Right,
right.
That goes back into a couple of residential houses there. Bruce Drive does. Yeah. Okay.
Well, I guess that's it. I'm in the info that I have.
That's all the information in there.
I move that we approve this.
Yeah. Second. Keith?
Yes.
Judy?
Yes.
Carrie?
Yes.
Rick?
Yes.
Tom?
Yes. Okay. That is all we have on the agenda, with the exception of we have some annual reports, and tonight we have the street department, the fire department, and the wastewater department. So we'll have those annual reports now, and then after that, we'll go around the room and then go into executive session. So first is Tyson in regards to the street department.
Good evening.
Good evening.
That's good.
You ready?
Yeah. Can you see?
Yeah.
Tyson?
Okay. Okay, we'll start with last winter with the 90-plus inches of snow that we had. We did a lot of plowing and hauling out of downtown. Like, that's pretty much all we did a lot of the winter. And then we spread 1,145.67 tons of salt, which for the amount of snow we had, that's about the average salt usage. So
you're saying that's the average
per year?
The average
per year is right around 1,000 tons.
Okay, so it was about
even
average.
With all the snow we had, we didn't use a whole lot more salt than normal.
Gotcha.
It's just.
Is that due to the
brine?
A little bit. And with the amount of snow we had, we didn't have a bunch of 1-inch snows. They were all 3- and 4-inch snows, so we plowed 90% of it and only salted it a little bit. Which, if we have small snowstorms on less than an inch or less than 2 inches, we use a lot more salt because we don't plow it. Mm-hmm. The next one is our employees, which at the street department we have 12. At recycling, we have 6, which Steve Warner is still the leader in years, at 26 years this year. There's a list of our routine duties, some of them, not all of them. We do a lot more than what's up here, but these are the main ones. You see down at the bottom, last year we cut down 82 terrace trees at court. Court goes around and decides which trees need to come down that can't be saved.
That's what you're into now, right now, correct? Or are they just trimming?
No,
they're tearing them.
We're cutting them all the way down right now.
Right, right, right. How many do you have on the list to cut down this year?
I want to say there was 90 some.
Okay.
I don't know exactly for sure.
And will you get all those 90 done yet this spring?
Oh yeah, we only have maybe 5 or 6 to go.
Oh really? Mm. Oh, okay, yeah. Gotcha.
And of course, the city leaf pickup. And pothole patching in our DuraPatch machine, which mixes the emulsion with the stone and sprays it out into the holes or into the cracks under the road. We use 3,100 gallons of emulsion.
I don't hear a lot of complaining about our potholes, so you must be doing a pretty good job. That's important. That maybe Mayor hears more than I do.
You get a few calls on us.
Yeah.
Tyson does.
I have to say, the last one on Fountain Grove Drive, I had just gotten ready to call him, and I drove back down the street, and he had already patched them in the morning, so
right on
they're pretty on them. And I think I passed you driving that street, so maybe you're checking on it every day to make sure.
All the truck traffic on that street right now, it's cold mix only lasts about a day or two, and we have to refill it.
Yeah.
So hopefully this summer we can use the DuraPatcher, which actually seals up the hole because it's hot liquid mixed with stone, and it'll actually stick to the road, where cold mix doesn't stick to the asphalt, especially in the wintertime when it's cold. So, which, and then Bryan's having that company grind it all up and redo that street, so hopefully that'll end that problem out there. It's a picture of the trash schedule. Here's our landfill report, which we took 2,769.3 tons of garbage to the landfill at a total cost of $202,000. You see that July is the highest month. In the warmer months, we take more to the landfill because everybody's working outside, cleaning their yards, doing more maintenance work on their houses.
I had somebody I had somebody tell me that for the weekly trash pickup, they don't wash out their bottles and things when they put them out there. Do you, what do you do with those when that happens? Do you use them anyway?
In the recycling tub?
Yeah, like a Miracle Whip jar or things like that. They don't, they said, oh, I never wash those out. I just put them in like that.
We'd like for them to, but
I know.
Probably, you know, there's a lot of people that don't.
Okay.
There's probably more people that don't than do.
Than do?
Yeah.
Then when they get to the, out to the recycle place and then they're sorting that out, that's where that smell comes from.
Oh, yeah.
It really got me bad.
It would help be very helpful if people would.
If people did wipe, wash them out. I mean, it takes them 30 seconds to do that.
Really helps.
And there's the same landfill, just in a graph.
What they say, we're taking more to the landfill, more tonnage to the landfill, but we're getting less dollars for it, you know. Or we're recycling more, but
recycling
we're getting less
more,
dollars for what
getting less
we recycle.
For it.
You know.
That's way down.
Yeah.
That's
yeah.
way down.
Yeah.
That Fountain Grove Cemetery, we had 33 burials, and we poured 20 bases for the headstones in 2015.
Do you, those bases, when you pour them, do you wait till you get 6 or 8 or 10 or something like that and then go out and do them?
We do them in the spring and in the fall.
Okay.
Usually, not usually, we do it before Memorial Day. That way they're in before Memorial Day.
Gotcha.
And then we'll do them either in September or October. That way it's more cost effective rather than to do them
one
base at a time because we'd have to pay the concrete.
Gotcha.
Plant a short load fee. Then on to the recycling center. We sold 812,374 pounds of recyclables last year, and that brought in $34,081.42. So it's a lot of material and not very much money.
Mm-hmm.
It's down a lot from previous years. The weights are the same or higher in a lot of it, but the price that we get for it is way down. Which I don't think, yeah, it's not up here, but in your packet, the last 2 or 3 pages from Mike. And the actual report breaks that down even more.
Do you see the per ton cost of landfill staying fairly stable? Or I know that was an issue ways back.
I haven't heard that they're going to go up. Nobody's, but a lot, not a lot of our costs, but some of the cost depends on the price of fuel.
Okay.
That's why we can't. I can't give you an exact number of what we pay per ton because every bill, it's different because of the price of fuel.
Oh.
We pay a fuel surcharge. The base rate is the same, but then they add the fuel surcharge. And all the dumping fees and tipping fees are the same, which those can go up whenever the state or the EPA decides to raise them. So I haven't heard they're going to go up, but that doesn't mean they're not going to.
We hope they don't go up.
Yeah. That's all I've got, unless there's more questions.
I know this was a joint police and street department issue a few years ago, but since the economy's gotten a little better, have you seen the people that, you know, we call them trash pickers around here?
The scrappers?
Scrappers, yeah. Have they stopped a little bit?
It's calmed down.
Okay.
There's still a few every once in a while, but it's not like it was two or 3 years ago because the price of scrap went way down.
Makes sense.
So they aren't.
And then Bryan, what's your opinion on that? Since we switched from Bryan to salt, are you liking what you see? I know we had a pretty
good
winter.
We didn't switch from Bryan or from salt to Bryan.
What was going on?
We added two.
Okay.
Okay.
Is that working?
Yes, it does what it's supposed to do.
Okay.
And the main thing, reason I wanted to do it was because when we would get a dusting of snow, we would salt and use 50 tons of salt. But now we can use Bryan and instead of close to $5,000 in salt for a dusting of snow, we can spend $100 in Bryan.
Wow, that's wonderful. Save that much. And does the same job or better?
Yeah, it'll melt ice and snow. I mean, you can't, it won't melt it as good as salt does, which I never expected it to, but it takes care of the small dustings of snow or a little bit of ice. It'll melt right through it at a fraction of the cost.
With our winter as mild as it was this year, are we in pretty good shape next year for salt?
Yeah. The barn is full right now. And I still have to buy, was it 300 tons?
That barn about 600 ton, is that what it is?
Six or seven.
Or something like that.
Oh, we're good for this week anyhow.
Yep.
Any other questions from council?
So it's costing us to keep our recycling going, which we're mandated to do. So we're not making money on it.
No.
Yeah.
No, by a long shot.
Yeah, I think people need to know that. Okay.
All right, thanks, Tyson.
Thank you.
Good job.
Thank you.
I think Chief Siders is coming this way for the fire department.
Good evening once again.
Good evening.
Council's been presented with a more detailed outline of the annual report than what I'm going to present here tonight.
It's a low one, Bruce.
It's the low one.
Problems. Yeah.
Well, you're gonna have to fix me now, Mayor.
Yep.
So I can get you going. There we go. Okay. Last year we had 439 calls for service, which was down about 4% from 2014. The chart that you see on the screen is the breakdown. This is how we report incidents to the state of Ohio through the National Fire Incident Reporting System. Most of our calls are good intent calls. As you can see there by the chart, 16% of our calls are those types of events. These are calls that people call in, they smell smoke or they smell something burning or here the past few months, the natural gas type smells in which we found out they were those cover crop radishes. that's those calls there. Our next biggest event are the assisting with the Williams County EMS with lifting patients, bringing them downstairs, upstairs, out of homes. And then false alarms take up the next biggest chunk of our call volume. Followed by fires themselves, and fires are classified as any type of burning, house, car, trash, and the like. So that's kind of gives you a breakdown of what our call volume is like or our experience. 68% of our calls are in the city of Bryan themselves. That is unchanged from last year. We did see a 1% increase in each one of the townships, including the county properties, from 2014. So we've had, our call volume is up in the townships as well. From the time that we are dispatched to the time that our first arriving fire truck arrives on scene, we're seeing an average response time of 5.5 minutes, five and a half minutes anywhere in the city of Bryan. So we're getting out the door in about 3.5 minutes on average from the time of dispatch, and then we're on scene within a couple of minutes after that inside the city. And then the townships, you can see there by the chart of how we're doing there. A lot of that has to do with Plaski Township, is how close they are to the city limits, as well with Center Township. Jefferson Township is far north of the city, so it takes us a little longer to get out there. And then the chart, the other chart that you see there is a 10-year comparison. As you can see, within the city, we're pretty flat. We stay within that five-minute timeframe and have for the last 10 years. Last year, Friday was our busiest day with 70 calls. Also, you can see by this chart that we stayed pretty busy every day of the week. We had a number of calls every day, but for some reason this past year, Friday was our busiest day. And again, the next chart there is the 10-year comparison. Again, everything stays pretty consistent, we've found over the last 10 years. We do have some anomalies now and then, but for the most part, we're pretty consistent as to how often we're busy, which is every day. By the month, we're always asked, you know, are you busier in the winter months than you are in the summer months? And our answer is no. We're busy all year round. In 2015, we were busier in January than we were in any other month. But again, we had all those snows. And when we had some of the warming periods, we ended up with a lot of busted sprinkler lines in buildings that didn't have heat in them. So that was what caused some of those calls in January. That's why you saw an increase there. Time of day, most of our calls start in at about 4 or 5 a.m. and they increase and they stay up until about 1, 2 in the morning, and then they start to taper off a little bit. The top chart gives you a comparison of 2015 versus 2014, and then you also see a 10-year trend there. Again, at about 5 a.m. we start picking up call volumes and they stay up until 1, 2 o'clock in the morning. Incidents by shift. We are divided into four crews. We have four individual crews, and we also, during the daytime, we supplement that with an on-duty staff. In 2015, the on-duty staff responded to 131 calls for service, which tells us that, you know, most of our calls are coming during the day, during the week, type of thing. General alarms are down because of the way that we have structured the fire department. Back in 2010, 2011, we restructured the fire department a little bit in regards to how we respond to calls, which has saved money immensely in regards to wages for firefighters responding to calls. So now we only send one piece of equipment to a fire alarm versus sending the entire fleet. Last year, we saved 65% of the property that was involved based on value, and that's pretty good. We did have a couple of high dollar losses last year, which really brought that number up for us. But again, we look at the property that is saved. So 65% is a pretty good number, I believe. Fire prevention. We believe that if we can prevent one fire, we've done our job. And we take a very serious outlook on fire prevention. We want to try to keep people from having fires. And we start at a very young age. We start with preschool kids, and we work with them all the way up through fourth grade. We're also out in the parks during the summer months when they have the summer reading and lunch programs. We also go around to the various factories in our fire district, and we do fire extinguisher programs with the folks. Training, again, I have to say that in regards to training, we are second to none in Northwest Ohio. Last year, the average per firefighter was 222 hours of training. We train on everything from fires to hazardous materials, EMS, technical rescue. We cover the gamut in regards to the areas that we're involved with the fire department. Of course, we're also involved in the community. We do special events. We go out to the kids' fair days that the Y puts on. We're at the Halloween festival that the city puts on at the park. And we also do various flag ceremonies for different events, 5K runs, funerals, things of that nature. And last year, we opened the firehouse up for a bike rally that was held for one of the firefighters, and that's one of the pictures you see there in the lower left-hand corner. I can't begin to tell you how many motorcycles there was that day, so there was quite a few. The parking lot was full. Of course, we're always looking for people. This ad goes out on our Twitter and Facebook page once a month, and we're always looking for people who are interested in volunteering with the fire department. So if you think you have a will or a want to, there's the phone number. Give us a call. We'll get you an application, and we'll start moving you through the process. Of course, I can't do it without some good people, and everybody on that list below my name, they do all the work, and they do a heck of a job for us. There's a lot of hours away from family events, anniversaries, birthdays, children's events in school. These folks put in a lot of hours and a lot of time, and you never know when they might be called out. So thank you to each and one of those folks, as well as their family, for allowing them to serve in their community. And thank you for allowing me to be the chief of the department. I appreciate it very much. You can always follow us on Facebook, Twitter, and of course at the City of Bryan webpage. That's my presentation for 2015.
You say average of 221 hours of training. Now, besides that, do you still hold monthly meetings with the department or anything like that? You know, we used to have regular every 2 weeks or every month a meeting of general.
The company, the volunteer company, has a social side, and they have a monthly meeting.
Gotcha.
Social.
They put on the 5K race, right, that we do annually. That's done through the volunteer company, and that meeting is once a month.
Okay. And then I know you have officers meeting as well.
Yes. Correct? Yes. We have officers meeting. We try to do officers training 4 times a year to make sure that we're all on the same page and we're not having any issues or any issues that might crop up. We can take care of those situations.
That's
as well as training
the
within the officer corps. Gotcha. For the fire department. Yes.
Okay.
Back on the emergency activity, I noticed in 2015 there was a big, big jump when I was reading this over. What sort of thing involves, it says other rescue, what sort of thing would that be in?
We had some elevator rescues last year, some folks stuck in elevators, and that really made that number jump.
Okay.
So we had some elevators that decided that they were going to take a nap. So we had to get some people out.
Do you have any program for junior firefighters or high school kids or anything like that would maybe aid you in your recruitment?
We do have a junior firefighter program. We operate one through the National Volunteer Fire Council. We used to operate one through the Boy Scouts, but they have a criteria that you have to have so many kids in the program in order to have a charter through the Boy Scouts. And we have not been able to generate those kinds of numbers because the kids are busy in school. A lot of school activities, a lot of other family activities that go on. But we do have a program for kids who are 14 years of age or older, out of the eighth grade, And we bring them up on Tuesday. They train with the firefighters. We allow them to do just about everything except fight fire. We can't let them do that. But they help us. They learn how to fill air bottles. They learn how to roll hose. They learn how to put up ladders and take down ladders safely. So they get to experience what it's all about to be a firefighter. And we've had some success in the past with the junior program. A lot of our folks that are currently on the department have come from the Explorer, the junior fire program.
How old do they have to be to become a firefighter? 18 or?
You have to be 18 and you have to have a high school diploma or GED.
And a diploma.
Okay. Any other questions for the chief? Okay. Thank you,
sir. Very much.
Thank you. Next, we have Mr. Rick Holmeyer, and he is going to give us a presentation on the wastewater department. Need to light up a little bit, Rick, or are you okay?
No, I'm all right. Thanks.
Okay.
First is the staff. There's a total of 6 people at the plant. And a couple of the guys advanced in 2015. Rodney Carlisle went from a wastewater operator 1 to a 2. And Josh Harper actually went from an operator trainee to a wastewater operator 2. And to advance to those, they have to pass a state test for the Ohio EPA to move to that. There, everybody's happy.
Yeah.
This one you've seen before. I think I developed this in 2006, but this is, I think I've referred to it as like a report card for the wastewater treatment plant. I don't know if you guys can see those numbers or not, but I'll just touch on the product we put out because that's the important thing. And we do a lot of sampling and testing. And I've got a laser pointer here too, I believe. Yes. It's right here, suspended solids. That's like the particulate, little bit of solids that's left in wastewater. If you can see there, the average it came in was 145, I believe, and where it left the plant was 7.6. To give you an idea of what that really equates to, for our permit in the summertime, we have to hit 15 milligrams per liter. And in the winter, 30. So we're way within that. And I can look back at these things from year to year, and they don't change very much. We have the same amount of percent removal there, too. In that case, I just can't hardly make that out. I think it's about 95%, though. CBOD, the next one, right here, final effluent. CBOD, the definition would be the pollutional strength of wastewater. And we got a 3 average for the year. And on our permit, we can be 10 in the summer and 25 in the winter. So you can see we're well within that. And that again is, I think, is that a 98%?
No. Yes, 97.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Permit removal. The next one, ammonia. And ammonia is toxic to aquatic life. I think we averaged 0.38 on what we discharged there, I believe.
Yeah.
And is that a 98% removal?
Yep.
And for that one, we can have a 1.8 in the summertime and a 4 or 5 in the winter. So again, we're well within what we have to hit.
Good.
I'll just look at one more of those, and that's phosphorus. And that one, looks like we're 0.238. Our limit on that is 1 milligrams per liter year round. Again, it looks like we've got about a 95% removal right there. That's a sanitary sewer overflow, something that I have not to report, had to report the last 2 years. There's a chart of, just since 2008, the red is the sanitary sewer overflow number, and the blue is the inches of precipitation. And as you can see, there's pretty much a direct relationship with rain and sanitary sewer overflows. Since we put that in July of 2013, we have had no sanitary sewer overflows. And I did kind of educated guess or looking at it, I would say in 2015, if we wouldn't have had that basin in place, we probably would have had a dozen overflows. Lab, roughly do over 5,300 in-house tests at the wastewater lab, and our contracted lab, 450. And a lot of those ended up getting reported to the Ohio EPA. Some of them are for process control for us to run the plant. I'll get to the projects that you guys budgeted for 2015. This is, first one is a, I think it was called digester sludge piping improvements, and we hired Peterson Construction to do that. The cost was 18. Yep, $18,000 to do that, and that's the valves. That's in the secondary digester. They added some piping and a few valves there in the primary, and that ended up being a very well $18,000 spent when it came to the project we had coming up with the digester cleaning and inspection project. This was another one that you budgeted for $18,000. Underneath that stone there is a 10,000-gallon fiberglass tank that we store liquid alum in. We use alum to precipitate phosphorus at the plant. That thing was put in the 70s. The tank itself was in fine shape, but the pipes coming up to the top were all corroded away, and we got to fill it through there and access that. So we hired local contractor Bryan Excavating to dig that up, change the piping, and pour the slab back on top of it. And again, that was money well spent. We talked to the engineer some about if we were to put a new tank in, we would have to have a building, it would have to have containment. So it's a repair instead of a replacement. And I think we're good to go for a long time. Just a few of the jobs that the guys did in 2015 here. Josh has made a stainless steel access for the condenser. We have media in there that it's part of the air pollution control for the sludge dryer. Another one is this air measurement device we have for measuring how much air we put out to our aeration tanks. And that's 1980s version of stuff. And we've always used it. It's been in the ballpark, but it actually failed. So we ended up having to take that project on. And our guys did it at the plant. They're tearing apart. And this made me my heart go up a little bit, because when you take this down, you're taking all the air off of our aeration system. So you want to make sure you got all the parts and everything working correctly. And we got it done. There it is, separated. Part of the old system, a big fiberglass venturi. And there's what replaced all of that is that sensor there that has a probe that goes into the side of the pipe. Another one was a our level sensing that we use for flow control. We had three pressure level sensors that we'd use, and we changed them out with ultrasonics. And the guys did that themselves. We had to hire Willis to run a little bit of conduit. there's Wes dragging a little wire around for that project, and we had Kester a short amount of time to do some control work. But that, it's a very vital part of what we do out there is the flow control. We did a small surface drainage project. We have about 60 tillable acres at the plant that we farm. And for a little bit of money, it's a good improvement, not near the cost of putting tile in the ground. This project was actually budgeted for 2014, and contractor didn't get around, so the roof did not leak, and we got it done in 2015. I think the project, there's two roofs, and it was $13,500, and those two are the last of 12 buildings out there on our campus. The rest all, the roofs have all been changed in the last 10 years. And those roofs we just replaced were put in the mid 80s, so I think we got our money's worth out of them. There's another one of the roof. The screw pumps, you guys probably heard more about the screw pumps than you ever wanted to hear. One of those is named after Doug Johnson. But a project that you guys approved was to, let us replace gates to isolate each one of these. This isn't a greatest shot, but each one of these, there's a concrete wall in between those. And we fabricated these gates and tried shoving them, and we did use them, but it wasn't a really good system, and they still leaked. And you gotta wonder when you're putting anchors into concrete like that, with the force going out, is it safe? So you guys approved, and that was a $35,000 project. Most of it was the actual equipment. We had some help from the street department fat pump. There's a common wet well in front of that, and then each one is isolated so that you can work on any of them and still have the other ones in use and not be up to your knees in water. So we had to use the vat truck. For whatever reason, when they designed that, they did not put a sump in there. So while we were at it, we core drilled and put a sump so that next time we will be able to use our trash pump and throw a suction hose in there and be able to pump that out. There's a shot of one of the old gates. And there's the new ones. There's actually three of them. And there's the pile of junk that we took out. Biggest project was the digester cleaning and inspection project. And that together was about $130,000, which you guys probably remember. We took 500,000 gallons of sludge from the secondary digester, tanked it over to a field, and then it was put in the ground with this applicator, actually knifed in. And I can say, I've been out there since then, and you can tell exactly where that sludge was applied from the setbacks. Alan Dean, it was his farm, and he called me, and I went out, like, it was unbelievably different. So we're doing something good with that sludge.
Now,
there's getting to be more people send it to the landfill all the time.
The reason we had a setback in getting it done was because we couldn't get on the fields with this operation.
And that was in the weather, the fall before we tried to do it. So this ended up being after the wheat came off. And while that was down, that thing hasn't been down since work was done 11 years ago. The guys replaced some valves on that typically they're charged. There's no way to replace those. And a valve needs to work when it needs to work, obviously. And we did one on the primary digester. This is a floating lid in a digester. That's a 70-foot concrete tank. And then that lid floats on top of a layer of methane in this case.
When you say 75 feet, you're talking about the diameter.
Diameter, 70 feet.
70 feet.
There's the access that the contractors and their hoses and equipment lay in there. Here's a shot of the inner, off of the ladder of the structure. You can see the skeleton of that thing. And here's a shot of showing, you can actually see the sheets of the protective coating are coming off, and this is what it was all about, to see the condition of this, to see is it repairable, or are we going to have to replace it? And as the company we hired said, this is repairable. So that's what we're working on, the project doing. Here's a shot of the piping inside there. There's kind of the stuff you're up against in a corrosive environment like wastewater. And there's some of the bolts. And my staff, anything that was questionable, we replaced bolts so that we aren't going to have a failure before we get this project completed. And we're big on stainless steel. This was Wilson Street lift station, and that control is from the late 80s, I believe. And more importantly, we replaced that panel in the enclosure. I should have got a picture of what's inside of it, because there's all kinds of electronic controls and components in there. We did that, that was a cost of $6,000. And the last major thing we did, if you remember, we had a fire in one of the blower controls transformers. There's four of those, they operate 150 horsepower motors. One of those caught on fire. And it's a huge panel that would be, it would put us out of business for a while if that whole works were to burn up. So I think you guys weighed in on it. We ended up spending $21,000 to replace the transformer on the other three of those. And that, it's really a neat picture, but what it is isn't so neat. That is the western basin of Lake Erie in 2014.
It looks like that in person, too.
And I can say that I don't think the Bryan wastewater plant had a lot to do with that going on.
That's good.
Well, that's all I have. Any questions?
Okay, for the sake of sounding dumb twice in one evening, because I know I thought our street department was replacing salt with Bryan, why do we farm 60 acres? Did I hear you say that?
Well, the city actually owned more than that at one time, and they used to land apply their sludge there.
Okay. And then, but are you guys farming it, or is that what Alan Dean was?
Alan Dean farms it for us. And then he maintains the properties and knows the SSO basin and keeps everything up to snuff. And I'm glad to say that he uses good farming practices. He has, he was doing cover crops before most people were, and I think he's a good steward for doing the property out there.
We appreciate that. I just didn't want to have that same question 4 years from now and never ask, I'm sorry.
Okay.
Also, feedback from EPA has been great, other than our project that we have, correct? Yes. Because I just saw letters where you had submitted things, and I'm assuming that with them, no news is good news, correct?
That's correct.
Okay, very good.
Rick, the only disposal of the sludge that we have is knifing that on the ground right now?
That, just during that project. Typically, what we do, we have Class A's. We have centrifuges, and then we have a sludge dryer, which makes a product called Class A. And that, there are not near as many regulations involved. What it does is it compacts the size and the amount that we have to deal with. And we produce, every 3 weeks, this dry, this process, we run the centrifuge two shifts a week, the dryer the same, and then in about 3 weeks' time, we give Alan Dean a call and say, come and pick your roll-off hopper up. He comes and hauls this dry product away, and then he land applies that on his other fields.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's his machinery that applying it?
That, no, that was a contractor.
That's a contractor.
Knifing it in. What we have is a dry product that is broadcast. It's like black sand is what it looks like.
I was going to ask that, too.
Good.
Anything else?
Good job.
Thank you, Rick.
Chief Siders, I had something written down I wanted to ask you is that I was driving down Wilson Street this afternoon, and I seen a house that I would guess it has, I don't know, 20 bags of trash on the front porch. Is that a hazard? Is that under your jurisdiction? Could that, is, or?
While it certainly is not good, it's not under my authority. That falls under the police department's authority.
So I'll move to the next chief and ask the same question.
Okay.
Not safe, but.
Yeah. So what did Chief Wilson, what do? I mean, you just knock on the door, and if they don't do it, I mean, you can cite them or give them a citation on that?
Sergeant Wangle is in charge of that. If we receive a complaint about anything that he goes down, talk to the owners, try to get them cleaned it up.
Yep, we prosecute them.
If they cited it, they fail to get cleaned up.
Okay. All righty.
So we, I mean, even as council members, it's no pressure. If we happen to see something and we call you and ask you to check it out, that's okay, or would you rather we not?
We'll check out.
Okay. All righty. Well, that concludes our agenda for the evening, and so I'll go around. Rick, do you have anything else to add?
No, sir.
Tyson?
No, sir.
Chief Siders?
No, sir.
Chief Wallace?
No, sir.
Captain? All righty. Judy, you have anything?
Just to say thank you to Sherry Cooper for her many years that she's put in for the city. It's greatly appreciated.
Carrie?
I would like to congratulate Sherry Cooper for breaking out of the police department. I hope she enjoys her retirement. And I'd like to thank Tyson and Chief Sire, sorry, and Mr. Holmeyer. For their reports. It was very informative. Thank you.
Mr. Rick?
Just want to echo those comments.
All right. Mr. Keith?
All I want to say is we've got to have City Bryan pride and keep our properties clean.
Okay. Ms. Lori?
No, sir.
Ms. Romney?
No, sir.
Okay, I have nothing else. Mayor, I think you have a couple of questions.
Yeah, going down. First of all, remind everyone of the time change. I put a little thing up there. Spring ahead, remember to move your clocks forward 1 hour at 2 a.m. Sunday, March 13th. Is that when we do your fire batteries and everything too, Bruce? New batteries and everything in your smoke detectors. So that's one thing there. Announcing the community drug awareness program. Let me get this slide to come up here. Oops, I get it turned the right way. There we go. Get it down to the right size, about 100%. Monday, March 14th at the Bryan Arts and Ed, they're going to have a community drug awareness forum for Williams County. Very important that parents go to this. And families. 4 to 5 o'clock, there's an educational presentation by the multi-area narcotic units for business owners, landlords, and school officials. And then 5:30 to 7:30, it's for the community. Speakers will include, they have various speakers coming in on that. So it'd be very important that we take part in that. And then a reminder and on your general information, the WEDCO meeting is March 17th at 11:30. You're to call Cindy if you're going to go to that, and she'll send in reservations for that. And that's March 17th, 11:30, and that's at the Veterans Building at the Fairgrounds. And then also a reminder that the auction for our ex-EMS building on Emmett Street is set for April 14th at 5 o'clock in the afternoon. We'll also be auctioning off a 1997 Tahoe with over 100,000 miles on that. And very important that you attend, and we want to raise some good dollars for that. Also, reminder, with that Emmett Street property, any buyer that buys that has to bring the electrical up to date as a requirement before they move into that. Had a meeting today with the commissioners uptown dealing with the construction that's going on, and there'll probably be a big article in the Bryan Times tomorrow on that issue. But from what we're involved with, the band, the community band that meets on Wednesday nights, those will be held at the Ice Arena this year.
All year.
You know, all year up there for several reasons, for insurance purposes, and they're gonna have a lot of fencing and so forth around, and a lot of wires, and it just wasn't possible to be up there. So they've already made that call, and we'll be at the Ice Arena for June and July for our band concerts. So other than that, I think that's about all that I have tonight.
Okay.
I echo too, for Sherry Cooper, a tremendous employee over the years that we've had her. So I know she's helped me out a lot when I needed some help too.
Okay, we're gonna take a short break, and then we're gonna go into executive session for acquisition of property and discipline of public employees. So that's it for now. Thank you.